I invite our Honorable Chairman, Dr. S.C. Vats, amidst roar of clapping.
A roar of applause should be for Dr. Shilpa Khatri Babu because she takes care of the students' welfare. She must have delivered a very captivating speech. And I, by contrast, may not be able to cope up with her comprehensions and her brilliant vision. She's a visionary. She's a lady of words. I mean, her vocabulary is fabulous. My vocabulary may fall short of her. She articulates it so well, and so the creativity manifests through her. She's a creative being. She can articulate things, you know, as the situation arises. About 40 minutes, I'm going to 35 minutes late. 30 minutes late, approximately. But then I had gone to a Gurudwara where I offered prayers for the departed soul. And I could see the ambience and the kind of environment. And one word that kept me spellbound is that don't ever grieve the loss of your kith and kin. In whose memory you have assembled here, they call it Sangha, Saat Sangharji. Guru Di Saji Navaji Saat Sangharji. What a beautiful expression, Guru Di Saji Navaji Saat Sangharji. What a respectful expression. Expression makes you what you are. The Oda Panamanna Nanak Tukhiya Sab Sansar Keval Tero Namadhar. Keval Tero Namadhar. How beautiful, how consoling it is. Nanak Tero Namadhar. Nanak Dukhya Sab Sansar. We are all tormented souls. We are not an integrated whole. We are fragmented. Our energy is frittering away. Every moment we are letting energy dissipate. Dissipation of energy makes you weak and makes you bereft of your conviction. So to be confident of what you are, you need to study things well in the right context. How many of you endorse the fact that we are a democratic country? How many of you know this fact, having passed your 10 plus 2, that India is a democratic republic? So half of you do not even know that India is a democratic republic. And why is the word democracy used with the republic? Anyone of you who can explain? Why is India called a democratic republic? Anyone? Please come forward. Please come forward. We are there to share ideas, interact, and you know, it's an interactive session. It's not mono dialogue. It's going from my side and you keep quiet. No, it's going to be interactive. Come on.
India is known as a democratic republic because we have the right to speak. We can present ourselves. If something is wrong going, we can question it. No issue, the person who we are questioning is on what stage, on what level. We can question the President of India and we can question the Prime Minister of the country. No matters if we are right. So that's why we are a republic country.
And if you're wrong then?
Mm-hmm.
If you're wrong then?
Then you will make me right.
Why is India called a democratic republic? Any more? The right to speech is not simply power to express yourself. Yes, please come. I'm glad some of you have the quest for knowledge. Good.
सर इंडिया डेमोक्रेटिक रिपब्लिक है क्योंकि हम खुद वोट देके अपना लीडर चूज़ करते हैं, अपने यहाँ कंट्री हम खुद रिपब्लिक मिलके चूज़ करती है ताकि आगे गवर्नमेंट चलाए, अपने लीडर्स हम खुद चूज़ कर सकते हैं, इसलिए हम डेमोक्रेटिक रिपब्लिक हैं, मिलकर साथ चलकर।
ये दो चीज़ें इकट्ठी कर दी इन्होंने, डेमोक्रेसी एंड रिपब्लिक, राइट। He has tried to define what democracy is all about and what's the republic about. But I'm not satisfied with this. With इनकी जो परिभाषा है उससे मैं संतुष्ट नहीं हूँ, प्रभावित भी नहीं हूँ, और होना भी नहीं चाहिए। ये कभी स्कूल से आए हैं, कॉलेज में प्रवेश किया है, इनसे पता करना प्रजातंत्र की परिभाषा क्या है थोड़ा ज़्यादा हो जाएगा। हम एक प्रजातांत्रिक देश में रहते हैं, प्रजातंत्र जो है वो कैसे गणराज्य बनता है, एक प्रजातांत्रिक देश कैसे गणराज्य में परिवर्तित होता है, मैं ये प्रश्न कर रहा था जो आपने थोड़ा अटपटा सा जवाब दे दिया। चलो पहले तो हम प्रजातंत्र को समझे क्या है। हाँ और इफ यू लाइक यू कैन स्टैंड नेक्स्ट टू मी, थैंक यू, गॉड ब्लेस यू। What is democracy? Tell me, how do you define democracy? Is it that we can be whimsical? I mean, we can use an expression, it's a democracy, and Pakistan is not so democratic, Myanmar is not so democratic, Nepal is not so democratic. Why do we call ourselves a democratic nation? What are the four pillars to democracy? Where nation qualifies to be a democratic nation? Any one of you can tell me the four pillars to democracy? Yes, please come. The four pillars to democracy, I mean, four pillars of democracy or four pillars to democracy. Come, Chai, my child, come. Very good.
The legislature, the executive, the judiciary, and a free media.
That's your definition.
A free press.
Yes. Now, I'll ask, no, it's not. There's nothing to clap about it. She has partly attempted the question, but not completely, not fully. She'll get just a little less than half mark. Okay, so anyone who can define what is democracy, what constitutes a democracy, what are those factors which can define a democratic nation? What are the four ingredients? There are four ingredients which defines and which clearly say these are the four pillars or the touchstones of democracy. If some country is preserving those four pillars, then you are a democratic nation. If you have preserved those four institutions, or you may call fourth estate, the third estate, the second and the first one, there are four pillars to democracy. If any one of the pillars has gone down, you will be not democratic. Any one of you would like to attempt all the four pillars to democracy? I think not much of them, because you must have lost your spirit sitting here for a pretty long time, but I'll not bore you, will not burden you with that, because you are just straight from schools. My expectations are a little too greater, I think. So there is one bright faculty here. I'll call the faculty member, Dr. Ashima. I'll say D. Ashima Singh Gureja. She'll tell you which are the four pillars of democracy. Because I am saying D. वो जिंदे जिदा कहते हैं नी कुड़ी कहते ना ये डी डी है डी अगे लग जाता है जिस दिन हो जाएगी PhD उस दिन मैं डॉक्टर लगा दूँ समझ गया ना पंजाबी समझ जाओ जिस दिन मेरा PhD हो गया उस दिन मैं डॉक्टर लगा दूँगा डॉक्टर आशमा सिंह गुरेजा हाले मेरे डी कुड़ी है वेरी हाईली एजुकेटेड डोंट ट्रीट हर लाइटली शी इज़ वेरी टफ मास्टर यू नो Behind her tough exterior is a very tender heart. She is a very good faculty, very knowledgeable. and she's going to tell me what are, which are the four pillars to democracy. What, when a nation qualifies to be a democratic nation, what are the four requirements that a nation should meet? She'll precisely focus on that. Yes.
First of all, I would like to thank my Honorable Chairman Sir. My introduction is Ashima, and my introduction starts from VIPS. I am a proud VIPSian from the first batch of this college, and I carry this college in my veins. So here I am as a teacher and also as your super senior. You can come up to me for any problems, for any issues, for any happiness, and for any sorrows. Now, the answer for the question, I might not come up to the exact expectation of my chairman, sir. The four pillars of a good democracy is a functional judiciary. One, the second pillar is a political army, a free and a fearless press, and a working legislature. Sir has his extensive explanation of it, and I might be wrong at somewhere, at some part. And over to you, sir.
God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Anyone giving correct answer, I'll give 500 rupees. Even 500 rupees I'll have to borrow from the Dean's Students Welfare. I don't carry money with me. So please, I mean, don't trust on me, but the Dean's Students Welfare will dish out 500 rupees from our pocket, and I'll give it to the person who tells me the exact definition of what democracy is. Anyone who can define, right from faculty members to the students, anybody who can stand and tell me in one go, just all the four pillars of democracy. What are the four ingredients of a democratic nation? Yes, you, the senior most and the former dean, and she is now looking after overseas, you know, your tie-ups. Dr. Charulata.
Thank you, sir. I'll just answer. The four pillars or four prerequisites for a functional democracy are a political army, independent judiciary, free and fair free press, and free and fair elections.
Very good. She will deserve 400.
Thank you, sir.
100 short. You deserve only 50 paisa. Any student wanting to attempt it? No. Okay, I'll tell you. Free and fair elections. In any country where there's a rigging, or you know, where the polls are rigged, that country is not democratic. So you need to ensure that in a given setup, you must have free and fair polls, free and fair elections. Write down, free and fair elections. Free and fair elections. Second is freedom of press. Write down. Write down. Write down these four pillars of democracy. Why? Because you are a part of this democracy. You are an integral part of being a democratic nation. You represent this democratic republic, each one of you. Now even the Dean's Students Welfare has gone to borrow money from somebody. That's the level of bankruptcy. You don't keep money in our pocket. She too has gone to borrow money. So first things, is free and fair elections. In a democratic nation, it's incumbent on the people who run this country to hold elections after an interval of 5 years. In some countries it is 4 years, in some countries it's 6 years as well, but must you hold free and fair elections. Second is, you must have an independent judiciary. Independent judiciary, no interference in judiciary. Wherever judiciary has been compromised with or pressurized to write judgments and do what the government is calling, whenever they have bent forward and backward to say, let's write a judgment whatever favors the government, then it's no justice. It's a miscarriage of justice. So independent judiciary, free and fair elections, independent judiciary, a political army shall not go before the political bosses. No, no way. Their command is absolutely independent, absolutely sovereign, you know, apolitical. They will not get influenced or colored by any political view. Apolitical army. Politics should not decide who the next general should be. It should be from amongst the senior army generals that one gets promoted to the chief of the army staff. It's from the naval services that one gets promoted to the admiral in chief of the navy. And the air force chief, they are selected purely on the basis of seniority and your competence and competence to deliver. So most of the time it's the western command of the army which is exposed to the line of actual control, that the lieutenant general, who is a corps commander of the western command, normally gets promoted as the next army chief, because he knows what are the strategies need to that will neutralize the army, neutralize the neighbor, and Pakistan or may that be China. So he has the war game in his mind, and he doesn't bend. There's a political pressure, you say, no, you please keep negotiations on with China and don't use strength. The army general is not going to listen. All these three army, you know, all these three wings of the army, they'll stand up and they'll say nothing doing. No political interference, let's carry the operations on, let's keep the pressure on the enemy. So then a political army which doesn't get colored or influenced by who the person is at the helm of affairs, what is their ideology, notwithstanding the ideology of a given party which happens to be at the center, right? So there's an apolitical army. How many are written? Three. Fourth is freedom of press. Freedom of press. Now that's where you are concerned. You are a part of the fourth estate. You are going to determine and decide how healthy is your democracy. How healthy is the democracy? Depends on press, responsible press. Independent but responsible press. Now each one of you has to be responsible for whatever you are reporting. I hope that clip has been shown which Mr. Kapil Sibal came here. And he said, categorically he said, the journalists of today or the scripts of today, whether they be anchor persons or reporters or in print media or electronic media, they need to equip themselves with the domain knowledge of a given discipline. Supposing you want to be a sports correspondent, you need to study the rules of the game. You have never played soccer, but yet you have to study soccer and its game if you really want to be impartially reporting as to what's going on the field. The ball-by-ball commentary is being reported here, and the whole thing is carried out on the sports pages of a newspaper. Sports journalism is another specialized area, sports journalism. Now medical research and medical negligence is catching up. You need to study medicine. You need to go around the Apollo hospital, seek an appointment with highly specialized doctors, whether that be in surgery or medicine or plastic surgery, or may that be any other field, and you need to acquire the domain knowledge of that discipline. Then only you can report a case of medical negligence. A doctor is negligent, and negligently he is indulging in more negligence, causing more deaths, more injury than causing healing. So then you can fearless report if you have an authentic knowledge. Authenticity of the source. And mind you, this, like it's the buzzword in the army or in the police, same as the buzzword for all of you, the budding journalists, that the source has not to be disclosed. You may have your person sitting there in the defense headquarters. He leaks out systematically the number of aircrafts that we have as against China. And that chip in the armor weakens the entire and demoralizes the entire moral, you know, the entire moral of the army and the people of this country. Somebody is trying to tamper with the moral. They are trying to demoralize the nation. They are trying to demoralize the army by saying, we don't have the type of weaponry, the superior weapons which China is equipped with. The Dokalam issue is very hot. And the Dokalam issue has to be studied in depth. You need to visit Sikkim and know where the Nathula Pass is, or you need to go around and see. I could watch one of the visuals being brought from the last village on the Chamoli district. Do you know its name? Mana. Mana is the name. Can you imagine this? And how we work there? How do we work there? The journalists must be well informed about it. How we work there? There's a tea stall there. Mana's last tea stall. But that's a camouflage. Remember this. That's a camouflage. There's the army people manning the tea stall. Remember this. There are other paramilitary forces which are deployed there, and it's incumbent on them to come to the tea stall and gather information on the movement of the army or the enemy army. So many things are created by the army to camouflage their activities. Intelligence gathering is something beautiful thing, you know, that can happen. Intelligence gathering. We try on the intelligence where to hit, whether to open an artillery fire or not to open an artillery fire. Is the discretion of the man at the who is at the command. Now would that I were in the army and I would have been posted there in Sikkim and Dokalam, the theatre of war, which is going to be a theatre of war. I mean, maybe it's there, maybe it gets averted, but China each time is threatening the sovereignty and the integrity of this nation, and that's why our army is in its full preparedness. And we are on heights, we are on a very vantage position. I mean, even a boulder if we throw at the enemy, I think hundreds of their Chinese will get killed. We are in very high positions, we are on great heights there. 6 kilometers of area was taken from China into Indian territory in the years 1967, when the war broke there and they intruded into our territory. We pushed them behind. Now, first thing is that they need to cover that 6 kilometers of. I'm sorry, I'll correct myself, 3 kilometers. 3 kilometers, China was pushed behind in this particular area, theater of war, which may be declared tomorrow, theater, at the timing which the government thinks appropriate, from the size that they have to look to the preparedness of all the 3 wings of the army. Now, Dokalam is the hotbed. And it's our concern, because this affects each one of us. We are a very ruthless, you know, and a very deceptive neighbor. I know. They can resort to anything. It can go nuclear, it can go chemical warfare as well. So remember, you should know that what types of wars can be there. Electronic warfare. It can be chemical warfare. It might poison your troops. And once you are on heights, the greatest danger is not from the artillery, because artillery fire cannot reach there, But then the air power comes into picture. They try to bombard your entire, you know, vantage positions that you have taken already. You have fortified your position there on the heights. Now, if they use their air power, they can destroy your bunkers. So your knowledge has to be multi-domain knowledge, multidisciplinary knowledge. If you don't keep company of good doctors or good lawyers, you will not be able to report from Supreme Court what landmark judgment has been announced, which article of the Constitution is being challenged, and on what grounds. From all channels, there is a newsroom there where the briefing takes place in the Supreme Court of India. So in the High Court, the Registrar General of the High Court or the Registrar of the High Court will come and brief the press. That's a landmark judgment where there is a constitutional amendment. So you need to be abreast of the legal knowledge. I mean, if you miss something on legal side, then you'll be all blank. You'll not be able to objectively report as to what are the long term, you know, implications of this amendment in the Constitution. Because it's the Constitution that embraces each one of our lives, that governs our lives. It empowers us, but at the same time, it makes us responsible to the law of the land. You cannot flout laws, you cannot flout rules. You have to adhere to the fundamental duties, as well as you have to care for the corresponding duties. Where you have the freedom of speech, you cannot give any inflammatory speech. Anything that, you know, incites the communal feelings of a given community, the Constitution lists in it the corresponding duties. With each one of the fundamental rights, there are corresponding duties which will tell you this is not to be done. You cannot disturb a neighbor. You cannot raise your decibel sound, you see, to high decibel thing sound, so that your neighborhood gets disturbed. So they have a right to life and their right to peace. The neighbor will immediately call the PCR and say, this gentleman is playing with my peace and he is not letting me sleep. He is having a jagrata or anything here in my neighborhood. I have a right to sleep. And that is a fundamental right. So police will take cognizance and will book you for raising the pitch of your sound. You cannot disturb peace. So what I'm suggesting is that you need to be equipping yourself with interdisciplinary knowledge. And unless and until you are equipped yourself with the best of legal knowledge, you are in touch with the best of lawyers, senior lawyers. How was this case argued for Kulbhushan Yadav in the International Court of Justice? Beautifully, you know, put in such literally, you know, what was the expression by Harish Salve, so beautifully defended. And the International Court of Justice unanimously, though they have judges from across the nations, but they unanimously said it's a complete human right violation. And ever since that time, they have not touched Kulbhushan. Leave part hanging. The Pakistan is on the verge of being listed as a terrorist nation. So on a diplomatic front, you need to study what diplomacy is all about. What is our foreign policy? And what are the factors that determine the foreign policy? The defense policy, the economic policy of the country. And your daily, you know, routine has to be very hectic. Let me tell you, ever since these channels 24/7, 365 days, what a pressure. It's a very, very demanding profession. Remember this, my children, you have enormous responsibility to discharge, to strengthen this democratic republic as very committed, hardworking, fearless journalists. Have you heard of Parkata? She went during the Kargil war reporting from a bunker. And she was conferred the highest award for journalism called Chamili Deva Award. For reporting right from the war front. So what you need is courage of conviction. What you need is fearlessness. What you need is objectivity to report. You cannot be misreporting. If you misreport, there's so many bombs, so many, you know, army fire and Pakistan enemy fire, and it bombarded so many bunkers, destroyed so many bunkers. Remember, you are demoralizing the military, you are demoralizing the army, you are demoralizing citizens of this nation and putting fear in them. So even if you have some setbacks, even if you have some setbacks, you are not supposed to be reporting that in national interest, because that's going to impact a common man on the street. It's going to put fear. What are you going to do? And the greatest strength of a person or a citizen is his moral courage. You need to have your morals, you know, boosted. You should be a spirited nation. Let's all stand united in the wake of a war. Well, I just want to tell you, it's not about the war. It's about anything that you want to report, even if you are getting contaminated water in your area, or your sewage system gets blocked. You need to study the sewage system as to what sizes of human pipes are fixed there, and whether they've been properly aligned, and with what material have those been aligned. Small, small things, the RTIs are fired day in, day out, where the entire sewage system has settled down. And there's a complete chaos in Delhi. Environmental pollution. You need to study environment. If you don't know how many parts per million of particles, hydrocarbons can be there in the air, you're almost illiterate. You should know how much nitrous oxide can be there, sulfur dioxide. There are three, you know, power stations, thermal power stations, which are consuming thousands of metric tons of coal. Power C station right here, next to your secretariat, Delhi secretariat, next to the Vikas Minar building, Power C station. Closed down by the National Grid Tribunal, because that used to consume a lot of coal, and which used to emit. The emissions were so polluted that those small particles will get into your lungs, block your alveolis, and your entire whole lot of your breathing system will become, and you'll be gasping for a fresh air. Power C station are closed down. Now there's another threat, Singrauli. Another threat, which is, you know, in the neighborhood in Uttar Pradesh, there's one Dadri, Charki Dadri. These are all thermal power stations, these are not hydroelectrical stations. So if you are not well informed as a citizen and as a journalist, what study or what reporting are you going to do? Of what interest is it to me? Why should I open the newspaper and read somebody's report? I only report out of my curiosity. Why are these hazardous thermal power plants are being allowed in the vicinity of this place? So power scenario, how many megawatts of power? Say like Delhi requires about 7,000 megawatts of power per day. So how is it generated? And what are the sources of generation? Is it hydro, nuclear, or it's thermal? Because these are the only source of electricity that you generate on. If you have not educated yourself about how much of contamination and how much of pollution a thermal power station causes, now next is Badarpur, right on your border. Tons and tons of sulfur dioxide is being released in the atmosphere, thereby causing atmospheric pollution. People like you have to be pioneering in taking up such issues after having studied the whole thing as to what are the compulsions of the, why should we generate power? These all power stations that I described, Singrauli, then Charki Dadri, then all these are the power stations which cater to 7,000 megawatts of Delhi power. So Delhi is becoming almost self-reliant in respect of power generation. But the water, you know, front, what are you doing? We are not able to have potable water in our houses. These are the issues that you need to take up. But you can only take up if you know whether it is to be measured in million gallon tons or in what, you know, there is an expression for it. How many MGD of water is required for Delhi? Each one of these areas you need to study well in depth. Then only you will be a well-informed citizen and a well-informed reporter. You can only report things when the facts are available with you. If you are off the facts, maybe people laugh sitting home at you. It's a bad reporting. You should be studying very well. You should get equipped with the interdisciplinary domain knowledge of each one of these areas which I have referred to. And journalist's job is very, very tough calling. I don't know why did you seek admission to journalism. Because doctor can get some reprieve after a surgery. Other professions can take rest after 10 to 5 work, 9 to 5 work. But remember this, there's no rest in journalism. You are 24/7 into 365 days. Anytime you may get a call from your headquarters, rush to that spot, report it from there. Such grave crime has taken place, horrendous crime has taken place. You are supposed to be reporting from that particular spot for the NDTV 24/7 or for Times Now or for any other news channel. Otherwise, and if you have to responsibly do that. You cannot ask if somebody has been murdered and you are asking the kit and kin, how is the body language? Absurd to ask this. Absurd to ask. So you need to have very polished knowledge. Your expression has to be very, very, very measured and calculated. So my children, there is a great responsibility which is cast upon your shoulders. I think you have made this journalism, mass communication as a choice because you see a lot of thrill in it. I was seen on the television by my parents and my friends and my peers, and everybody will say he or she was there anchoring a news, prime time news. Yes, that's a moment of pride. But remember this, even one line if you go MS, you are immediately sacked. There's no job guarantee. People going around these newspaper offices applying and they remain unemployed, but because you lack knowledge, you lack information. Information is power. You well informed, you keep yourself well informed. Keep yourself absolutely on the guards all the time, keeping your body fitness. So that at the mid of night when there's a call, please cover that crime scene there, a road accident has taken place, a BMW or the luxury car has met with an accident, there was a rash and negligent driver. You need to catch up with the scene of the crime and the person who has committed the crime. And from there you need to keep the countrymen informed, this is how it is, and this was such and such Nanda's negligence, their brat's son, and who was driving recklessly has done this. You need to highlight the misery of the common man, their problems that afflict the society. So your responsibility is enormous. I don't know, I mean, how many of you willingly or unwillingly joined this profession of journalism, which is very demanding profession. You cannot rest even for a while. After you pass out your 3 years from here, you simply will have one good certificate of Bachelor in Journalism, Mass Communication, but that's not to journalism. Journalism goes far beyond the frontiers of 3 years course. You need to touch those areas. You need to interact with doctors, engineers, technocrats. You need to go to the ISRO scientists, catch up with them. There's a DRDO office at Metcalf House. Go there, try to know what's the latest technology. And that's how you keep updating and upgrading your knowledge, and then you will be the most sought after journalist. He or she does, she's industrious, she's hardworking, she's very well focused on her job, or he is very well focused on his job, you'll be in demand. Otherwise you'll be redundant, completely redundant, you'll be dumped. For some time you'll appear on the television screen, thereafter where did you disappear? Because the news channels are also being run, unfortunately for this country, by people with a vested interest. Where most of the, you know, it's not more of, no more, and we can say that's a completely, you know, free and fair, you know, poll. Polls are also rigged. It's not freedom of press, it's complete freedom of press. The complete of freedom of press is stifled. Each one of you is given, this is how much you, news you can carry. Many times your editor will just trash it. No, you've not done it responsibly. Why? But because the masters want it to be reported in a different way. So in media, ever since these big business houses have entered, the priorities of a common man have been put in the back burner. What should matter to you is to raise and highlight, but you will have very restricted freedom of expression. Very restricted freedom of writing. News channels will give you a script you only need to read out. That's all. You need to call a minister, embarrass him, grill him, so that the so-called industrialist or the media baron who has opened such a channel can take advantage. You are doing the job, but remember, somebody else sitting in his cozy office is blackmailing that particular officer who has done a good job. So you are used at times as a tool. We still call freedom of press. No, it's not freedom of press. The press has to be more responsible. How many of you can appeal to the Editors Guild of India? Do you know what is Editors Guild of India? Editors Guild of India. Any one of you know what is the Press Council of India? These are the regulatory bodies. But each one of them, from one time good reporters, have become media barons, like Pranav Roy, the owner of 24/7. The Times Now, completely doctored news and more of bullying on the channel. They embarrass the guest. You are calling somebody from a department or an expert in a given area, you are put to a lot of embarrassment. Now Arnab Mukherjee says, now don't worry, I have left Times Now, there is an improvised version where 40% more harassment of the guests can take place, that is the Republic channel. But these are the type of channels, you know, which are owned by media barons, which are Rajat Sharma. He takes up a character and who is nobody, but he wants to be on the right side of the establishment, so he'll call the president of the party, highlight all his achievements, give him every opportunity to address the audience in whatever manner it suits him as per the ideology of his party. So there are so many things which will influence you. But if you really want to empower yourself, the only way to empower yourself is to equip yourself with the interdisciplinary knowledge and to be so well informed that you can even embarrass the media barons and those owners of Times Now. And Pranav Roy, most of the time, is a very responsible. He has risen to the level of a media, owner of a media, owner of a channel. But still, I tell you, in one of the, you know, outcomes of an election, his things went wrong. And he forecasted that such and such party is going to win, and that it was just the opposite that happened. The other party won. And the party that his sophologists, people who carry out those surveys, they had predicted the other party's win. Pranav Roy had the modesty to apologize to the listeners and to his audience of the channel, and said thrice, I apologize for having to give you wrong figures. There are people who have risen to the level of a statesperson, they say, no, I am supposed to disseminate knowledge which is confirmed, which is verified, which is authenticated, and which is from the right quarters. Each one of them come out of the pre-poll surveys. Pre-poll surveys also are sponsored by political parties, and they want to show that they tilt the balance there. They influence a common voter's mind, and the common voter minds, you know, it gets so baffled, whom to vote, whom not to vote. They say this, their win is forecasted. The new channels are playing this game, you know. The victory is victory forecasted beforehand. The common man of this country living in the hinterland, he thinks in any case this party is going to win. Why not vote for this particular party? So they influence, you know, people's mind. They influence the audience, and they want to change the electoral prospects of a party. To this extent, there's an interference by the media barons. So you are working in very challenging times. You have greater responsibility on your shoulders. But many of you may not be able to register the initial years. You grew up first, get employment, get empowerment, and after you get empowered and you gain sufficient strength to challenge somebody, then there are channel rivalries as well. There are channel rivalries. You can join a rival channel and say, such and such was a misreport, I am trying to correct it here. And the channel, you know, TRP goes up higher because of your credibility, because of your objective study of a given thing. And you are held high, you know, you are held high in their esteem. They say, oh, this is a gentleman, he is a lady or a gentleman who has brought the correct report, ground report, and exact, precisely correct predictions are made about the electoral outcome of a particular party. There are very many people who have made millions of rupees. They have launched many portals where precisely there used to be tehalka.com, then came a cobra.com, then it keeps evolving. I mean, the cyber media is now evolving, is gaining strength now. So if you look for, I mean, a news which is very fair, you need to surf all the channels and find out which is doing an objective reporting and which is doing a false and fabricated reporting. So don't let the scales of justice tilt in favor of the one and against the other. You have to uphold those scales of justice in your hand and balance it in a manner so that you don't compromise on your integrity, but at the same time remain employed. Because employment will be very essential. The bread and butter must come. Butter may not come, but bread should come. So while you're earning your bread initially, you may have tough times with the media houses. You may have to go knock at their doors. We'll also help you in placements, but it's not all we. You too have to be one of those selling points. He or she has got the strength. You need to build up your own inner strength as well. You need to build up on your capabilities, because nobody wants a liability. Everybody wants an asset. So for placements, much will depend on your hard work, on your ability to equip yourself with interdisciplinary knowledge, so that each one of you can proudly say, on this area, I am the last word. And on this particular area, I am the strategist, I know, I keep doing this, and I keep interacting with the army generals and people with modesty. You go approach them. They're very nice people. They'll give the most authentic information. But never, never ever leak your source. Source has not to be revealed. These are the journalistic ethics. The police also doesn't reveal its source. Because some people reporting crime and informing the police station, the station house officer, is doing a job to prevent crime. See, like in the vicinity, I'm told, there are some panwadi shops or some people, you know, preparing momos for you. But in the garb of momos, they are dispensing some dangerous MSD and drugs. In my neighborhood, on this particular road which leads to the canal, and if you go 500 meters on the right side, and another 200 meters this side, and onto the Jugi clusters, I have now gathered all the intelligence on that. And yesterday I called the station house officer, I informed. I said, these need to be removed and checked off from this area. So first thing, you need to gather intelligence. You need to have the right source to tell you, because some of the advocates, they went to a senior chamber. And as they were intermingling with the senior was asking, how was the faculty there? He said, brilliant faculty. Then how did you find the crowd? Very good. very nice people, very good gentry, very good background, they are coming here. Then what's the deficiency? He said, when we studied there, there used to be a few shops selling momos, and under the garb of selling momos and the cigarettes and the other things, they are selling MSD. Beware of this. Any one of you found out there will lose his career. We have zero tolerance for ragging, for harassment, for any kind of inconvenience being caused to your peers. Please keep your hands off if you are, any one of you is under the influence of that. None of you will be spared if you are found erring anywhere. So this is just a caution to you. No ragging, zero tolerance for ragging. Zero tolerance for your conduct with your opposite sex. Nothing of untoward should happen in this area. We have 17 years history, clear history of conduct, having the right conduct of our students. So right conduct you have to have in life. You have to have a sense of duty and sense of responsibility. Do your journalism mass communication with devotion and dedication, with respect to your teachers, by paying attention in classrooms, and get as much information as you can, because information is going to lead to power. Power is going to lead you to placement. More informed you are, the better the placement you will get. Your communication skills should be wonderful. Your vocabulary should be very rich, because when you express yourself in a newspaper, 100,000 people are reading it, and should be grammatically correct. It's vocabulary wise, the word, use of words should be proper, at a proper place. So there has to be no mismatch on that. Script writing is itself a very, 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 very challenging job. So I'll not touch upon, just remember one thing. You have a responsibility, enormous responsibility cast on your shoulders, and each one of you has to rise to the occasion and take a pledge. Take a pledge that we'll do whatever is possible to strengthen this democratic republic called India. We'll not do a thing which will be prejudicial to the interests and the sovereignty and integrity of this nation. We shall do an objective reporting, but a fearless reporting, notwithstanding whether a good job or a bad job, but any type of job that we are asked to do, we shall be doing with great sense of responsibility as a citizen. So with these words, my children, you have had a lot of patience. I expect each one of you, the next time I meet you, should be seeing you as an anchor person, as anchoring a news or a program or holding an event, I want to see you, those event managers, newscasters, broadcasters, and some of you, I mean, showing your talent somewhere. So I will be proud of you. Thank you very much. I'll borrow 500 rupees. And I know she too has borrowed from outside. She went out a couple of times. She too must have collected by now. You owe 500 rupees to Charu ma'am. Applause for her.